Hello, I'm David DeCosmo. Welcome to ECTV Live. I'm joined, as always, by my host, Rusty Fender.
A little bit better weather. Good to see you. Official full week of spring, Dave.
As April approaches, there are some subjects that come up that are very, very important. And we try to do at least one show every year pointing out that April is Distracted Driving Month. This has become a very, very serious issue throughout the United States. Our guest, she always joins us for this particular show, is Eileen Miller. And Eileen became all too tragically aware of distracted driving. With Eileen, just kind of back us up, if you will. I know we do this all the time, but it's important. And as you tell us, I'm going to grab some photos here and show the folks what we're talking about. So go right ahead.
Well, on July 5th of 2010, my son was tragically killed by a distracted driver down in Hamilton Township on Route 33. And since then, I've been an advocate of distracted driving. One thing you never want is two state troopers to come knocking at your door telling you that your son, your child, your loved one was tragically killed due to distracted driving. At the time, we didn't know that that's what it was. But on July 4th, my son went to visit friends for the 4th of July, and he was at East Ellsburg. My son was a criminal justice major, so he did 2 years here at Lackawanna College, and he did 2 years at East Ellsburg. So he went to visit friends down for the 4th of July weekend, and he did the right thing. He stayed overnight. He had two beers, not that he was drunk, but he wound up being further down. He wound up being in Bethlehem. So it was an unfamiliar territory, didn't know where he was. So he did everything right and stayed overnight. And the next morning he was on his way back to work at Garrity's. And also that would have been his very last class at East Ellsburg University. That day he would have went back and finished his last class. And then he was going to start his internship here at Lackawanna for youth probation. So he was on his way back. It was early that morning at 7:55. He was coming north. Tractor trailer driver was going south, and people had witnessed him from 80 going onto Route 33. He was kind of lane switching, speeding
the
up the road.
Tractor trailer. Mm-hmm.
Right, correct. On the road, off the road. And what had happened is he had jackknifed then, crossed over the two lanes of highway, a grassy medium, and he hit my son head on. And that was it.
There's a picture of the tractor trailer involved and your son's car.
My son's car. He was in a Toyota Corolla. He wound up going over the hood, hit my son right in the driver's seat. My son's body, we didn't know at the time because the state police did not tell us. But we told him, you know, he had markings on his body and that they said they weren't on there. We didn't realize till later that my son's body was actually dragged down the highway and was laying on the side of the vehicle. Following behind my son was a van full of 12 illegal immigrants in it. And then that wound up hitting into the tractor trailer. So they were all injured. Three of them were life-flighted. So, you know, two state troopers came knocking on my door. They said they had reason to believe that it was my son, but they couldn't really make sure that it was him. We told them he had tattoo markings on him. They said they weren't on him. It was kind of a back and forth situation, but tragically, we later found out that it was definitely my son that was killed in that accident.
And that the weaving that was witnessed was not a drunk driver in the case of the tractor trailer driver, but rather this whole issue of distracted driving. How so in that case?
Well, we found out through his statements and that he said he had to ping one phone to reach for his other phone that was jammed up underneath the seat. And that's how we started to believe that that's what it was. He had two cell phones that day, his personal phone, and he had a work
company phone.
Phone. And he never even knew he hit my son. He never even knew he hit him till he went to reach for that phone underneath the seat. And when he looked for it, he looked up, and there he saw my son's car crushed in front of his car, and that's how he knew he hit him.
As we spoke about it too, I reported that morning on KRZ and Froggy 101 as traffic, not knowing at the time it was a fatality, but it was kind of out of our area of being at the Northampton Monroe County line there,
right,
in Hamilton Township, but it was such a horrific crash that closed the highway both directions for a better part of the day that I reported that, not knowing that this was the actual culmination of that crash.
Right.
Now, since that time, as you said, you've been involved in an ongoing campaign to make people aware of distracted driving and the dangers of distracted driving. I'm tempted to say, you're getting anywhere with it? Legislatively, I think you've made some inroads, yes?
We have. We just found out again the handheld bill just went dead again, but they just did pass a law called Daniel's Law, which is if you are injured or if somebody causes bodily harm by texting only, you can get up to 5 years. It is a better law. So they did make some kind of headway with that. That had just passed legislation. Governor Wolf had just signed that. That was held to a gentleman who was killed by, he was on his motorcycle and he was hit by behind and he got killed. So we are making a little headway with that, which is good. It's supposed to be held up to like a DUI, kind of. We're trying to make better legislature with that.
And let me say that you're high on the list with PennDOT, being an employee of them, because James May, Dennis Giordano, and George Roberts from District 4 in the Keystone Industrial Park, you are high up on the list of protocols for which positive action is being taken on this. So
correct,
you know that.
Yeah. I work very well with them because Paul was killed in a work zone. He was going 69 in a 45-mile construction zone, so that was another thing.
Again, the tractor-trailer driver.
Tractor-trailer driver, correct. He was speeding in a work zone. So I work with them, trying to make, you know, when I go out to the schools and I talk to children, they're not even aware that they're not supposed to be crossing that white line. A lot of them don't even know. A lot of adults don't even know that white center line you're not supposed to
that's
cross
correct.
Over.
That's correct. It's like a double yellow line. It's the same thing in a work zone. It's a single or double white line. That's correct.
Correct. A lot of them, when I ask them these questions, a lot of adults don't even know.
It's amazing because I think you take a driver's test and you kind of study and you know I have to be X amount of feet from a fire hydrant when I park.
Right.
And then as soon as you got the test, you got the license, those things sort of fade into the distance. And I know right now, Rusty, you can attest to this, there is I don't know if it's a policy or a law where if a state policeman has pulled somebody over and you're in a two-lane highway, you're supposed to get in the left lane.
That is correct.
Totally away from him.
And you know, on the heels of what you said too, things do change. Mm-hmm. And a lot of folks aren't really notified of these changes. We all know how many feet from a railroad crossing
true,
and a fire hydrant. But these things do change. Like, you know, when we took the driver exam, Dave, you and I, these work zone things didn't even exist then.
No, yeah.
So things have come in the last 20 years, which have been, you know, precedent setting, actually.
Right.
So that's the part a lot of people just don't
know.
Know.
Right.
You know, what baffles me is that the first thing you think of when you talk about distracted driving is in this case, the cell phone, which has now become as common as a belt on a man and a person in a woman's hand.
Mm-hmm.
And you would think the technology is readily available to have one of those available hands-free. You don't have to even touch it. And yet you say the legislation requiring hand-free is not going anywhere.
No, it's not. And I want to make this perfectly clear. Everybody thinks that hands-free is not risk-free. That is completely false. You are, when you have a handheld set on, you are still distracted in your brain. Your stopping distance is slower. Your reaction time is slower. I know many people that when just because they were talking on their phone, they've lost their children. Your brain, you have that inattention blindness. When you're driving and you're talking to somebody on your phone, you still have, inattention blindness, which means, you know, like I said, your reaction time. A perfect example is this, is you watch a TV program mm-hmm. and you have somebody call you on the phone. And you watch that movie and you talk to somebody and then trying to remember that
program, you're going to miss something.
You're not going to have that full thing. So everybody says, you know, well, I can talk and still drive. Well, how many times have you driven somewhere and you've missed an exit? Or how many times have you driven somewhere, you know, in your conversation, you know, you don't get that full that thing.
But the good thing is the baby step is the tractor trailer drivers in the state must be hands-free.
Right, correct.
And that is a good step, albeit
correct.
A small one.
Now, that is a law.
That
now.
Is a
correct.
Law. You have to be either Bluetooth or you have to have some type of hands-free device, tractor-trailer drivers. You always see them with the tractor, with the, you know, with the Bluetooth.
The headset,
they have to.
Yeah.
They have to. That's a major loss of a license for a tractor-trailer driver should they be caught with a phone up to their head. That's a good thing.
And that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to get it out of their hands before they cause the crashes, because now the texting law, it's very hard to enforce. You can't tell whether you're scrolling, emailing,
you're
texting,
right,
and all of that, and that's where we're at. So it's baby steps. New York, New Jersey, I love them all. They have texting zones. They have, you know, points off your license.
And Connecticut.
Yes, they do.
And,
they have
and very I know strict, in New York State, hard, it's strictly enforced.
You bet.
Yeah,
yeah.
Oh, they're very
yeah,
tough.
Yeah, New York is tough.
They're very
yeah.
tough.
Very tough.
And that's my goal someday. I mean, I keep trying, and we're going to keep trying, and I'm not going to give up till we do that.
What seems to be the holdup?
I don't know. I mean, it's the state reps that we have to talk to, and we keep going back and keep trying and trying. It just keeps going dead in the committee. It just
I mean, I wouldn't
dead.
Think there'd be any big lobby against something
especially
like that.
Especially when
sure
your surrounding
is.
States
sure
are smothering are. You with these laws already.
Yeah. I mean, we have car manufacturers now. They're putting connections right to Facebook. I mean, the car manufacturers themselves are putting all that in
well,
there.
Now you bring
you
up...
You have cell phone companies that are yeah. lobbying against, I mean...
You bring up something else, and I wanted to bring that up this up on this show. I happen to like older vehicles.
Right.
All right. It'd be okay with me if we went back to carburetors, but they're all electric.
I don't think that's going to come back.
Don't start showing your age.
When I get into a new car, when I'm in somebody else's brand new car, for instance, the first thing I notice is in the center of their dash, there's a screen.
Correct.
There's a
yes.
I mean, you call it what you want. To me, it's a television screen.
Correct.
It may activate a backup camera, mm-hmm. and I can see the value of that.
Right.
Although we do have a thing called a rearview mirror
right.
that I'm
right.
pretty used to.
It's navigation, although we do have a thing called a roadmap.
Right, right. But you've got all of this, and especially navigation.
Yes.
You've especially got your Garmin, your GPS.
Correct.
Is now built right into that screen. And again, I can see where it's extremely handy. I've made a couple trips to Philadelphia recently where my GPS has been vital, but what I do is once I've got a satellite, I put it down here and I listen to the voice mm-hmm. saying turn left or take this particular exit. I don't have to see the screen.
Right.
But it seems to me that the technology in the cars today defeats your
sure,
purpose.
It's more distracting.
Good point.
It's more distracting. It's more distracting.
Yeah, I mean that you're gonna be watching these things.
Right. And that's the whole point of why there's more crashes today in the world, because it's taking for some things it's good for, but for others it's not.
He's right. It's
self-defeating.
I remember when you the first big deal, and this is back in the early 90s, when you could change the radio stations without taking your hands off the wheel, because
yeah.
you always
yeah.
want them in the 9 and 3 position.
Right.
And it's kind of like that defeats what's going on now. So great technology 20 years ago is now obsolete
yeah.
technology 20 years 20 later.
20 years later.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, I can see where it would have a negative impact on the whole idea of distracted driving.
Right.
Again, you say you're making some inroads, and yet we see that the hands-free is not going anywhere. Do we have statistics as far as saying, yes, we've got 2,000 crashes and 100 of them are distracted driving?
There are statistics. I don't really focus on the statistics because they're changing every day. Like in Paul, that was back in 2010. He wasn't even a distracted driving fatality. He was just a road crash fatality because the police didn't look at the phone. They didn't even go towards it. They didn't even do that. Today, they are getting better with it. But unless somebody dies with the cell phone literally hanging to their hand like this, they don't even go look at the phone. I mean, today, that's where the police and that have to really start investigating it and look at it. I mean, they don't really look for the phone itself unless they really see it ringing at the crash site
yeah.
or that they don't really, it's hard for them to investigate
and
it that way.
And then you get
the
into
statistics.
The privacy end of things.
Of
they
course.
Always say, you can't stand behind someone at Rite Aid within 10 feet with this privacy.
Right.
So it's like they have murderers and people convicted of horrific crimes and they can't, Yahoo and the
right.
providers can't go into the phone to
it's
see if there's any...
Right.
I mean, I think yeah. that's absolutely, that defeats technology, let alone, you
technology
know.
Technology has good things.
Oh,
but there's
gosh, they can't go in because it's a privacy thing of the person who may have killed 10 people,
right.
but they can't go into that phone.
I believe if there's reasonable suspicion.
I think you're right.
They can at least
right.
check a phone for
right.
you're right.
when was this last text
if people witness
right,
or
right.
people see them driving and they're talking on the phone,
right.
if people can see, like we were just unfortunately in August hit again by a distracted driver on 80
you were
right
hit.
By yes we oh. were our our handicap van, because, you know, 2 years after my son got killed, my husband was diagnosed with Lou Gehrig's disease.
Yes, yes.
They believe the stress and anxiety from my son passing. We were going right before the turnoff to Route 33. We were stuck. It was on a Sunday, and they had the raceway was going on.
Oh.
And we were stopped dead traffic for miles. We were going a couple feet, stopped, going a couple feet, stopped. And of course, we heard ba-boom, you know, our car went, my radiator went, and we were able just to pull over to the side. Of course, as soon as I looked in the rearview mirror, the guy had his cell phone right up at his steering wheel. So I got out, I went back to him, and I said, buddy, I said, you were on your phone. And he said, well, I wasn't paying attention to the road. I said, that was your one and only task. I said, you followed us for miles. How could you not see me? Well, we both wound up going to the hospital. My husband had neck injuries, I had back injuries. And I told the state trooper, I said, he was on his phone at the time. And the first thing he said to me was, if he doesn't admit to it, you know, I can't subpoena him. I can't go into his phone. I couldn't. But when we got to the hospital, he came and he said he did admit that he was distracted driving.
One lucky break.
So I was like, well, my son got killed. He wasn't a distracted driving fatality, but this was reported as a distracted driving. So it will go in the statistics for 2016 that he was a distracted driver. And I thought, this is crazy. I got hit twice. I mean, they were going to total our van.
It same area.
13,000, yep. And then my husband started getting very upset because he realized that that was the first time we were at the hospital since my son was killed, that we were going to the same hospital.
Yeah. So yeah, that's got to be a tremendously traumatic experience. You know,
That was right before the exit where you turn off to 33, we got hit.
And so, I see a growing danger in the sense that, if we go back to what you said about Rusty, when we took our driver's tests and such, now you have a generation of young people that are becoming drivers to whom the cell phone has become an extension of their hands and
absolutely.
Their arms.
Right.
I mean, to us, it was something new when it came along.
You're right.
To them, it's so common.
It's an addiction.
Yeah.
Everybody constantly is on their phone, no matter where you go, restaurants, walking. It's an addiction. Every time people hear that beep,
it is.
You know, that ping, they want to reach for it. It's just like a drug.
It's instantaneous society. You have to return that text at the moment. You have to return that phone call.
Right.
You have to check Facebook when somebody posted something to your site.
Right. It's instant gratification.
We'll never go back out of that. It's an instantaneous media society.
Right. And you know what I tell people all the time? You know, like they see it, if they see a crash, like at my son's crash, or a lot of families that I know who have lost loved ones, if you see it, go over and help them. Don't take a picture of the accident and post it up on Facebook. So many of our loved ones that I know, you know, they're right away, they see a crash, they have to hurry up and post it up before our loved ones are even notified about it. You know what I mean? Before they even know, they're seeing it on social media.
This was a big concern
when
terrible. I was on the news beat.
Right,
when
television.
We were on the scene of an accident.
Yeah.
And you want to make sure you don't show that license plate
or give
But people don't
visual,
think today.
Yeah.
They don't.
Yeah.
They want to hurry
until
up and
the next
look what I saw.
Is notified.
Here's
it was a big television thing, which
a
was
A lot
good.
Of our loved ones, a lot of my families that I know today, before they even get to find out, it's already posted and it's already up there. And it's sad because people today, they don't think with their brain because they're just so into social media
instant
and they want to get it up. Right.
Yeah.
Oh, there's a crash on the highway. Oh, but before the family's even notified, they're getting this information out because everybody wants to hurry up and get stuff today out on social media.
Right.
And they have to think, please, with their heads before they hurry up and tweet and post and get stuff out there. You know, what got me more than anything this year was, you know, we're trying to get awareness out for our cause, you know. Somebody passed at the Grammys, you know, the wrong envelope because they tweeted it out wrong. And these people are all over the media because of the wrong envelope because that was distracted. He gave out the wrong envelope and they're all over social media.
That's
and it's going
point.
On for on and on and on. And here
good
we are
point.
Trying to get our message out about distracted driving, about our loved ones. And we can't get any media attention about it.
Yours involves a death. That was
ours
just
are death.
That was just
that
an embarrassment.
An envelope, right.
Absolutely.
By the way, that was the Academy Award.
Academy, excuse me.
That's right.
That's how much I pay attention because I'm too focused on my advocacy work.
You know what I'm thinking? Perhaps the biggest danger is with regard to distracted driving and its potential effect on everybody, is the idea that people who are watching are saying to themselves, this is a real tragedy. This is horrible. This can't happen to me.
Yeah, I thought that myself until two state troopers walked up to my door. I mean, I was always an advocate of safety anyway. You know, I was, like I told you before, I was always the one that, you know, when my kids were into rollerblading, you know, I had the helmets, the knee pads. You know, when the Razor scooters came out, I had a pool. I always had CPR. I was the one that was always chasing every kid down the down my driveway, you know, wear that seatbelt, you know. Never thought I would be the one going to pick out my son at the morgue. It wasn't not my child who did it. It was somebody else's bad mistake.
Which goes back to the 1960s commercials where you got to watch out for the other guy.
For the other guy. My son was the one who did everything right. But with all that being said, you know, people, when they're in their vehicles, need to get to point A to point B, and they need to get there safely. And they need to, you know, like I always say, I use the word pass. This was from James May. I was saying the same thing, but he put, you know, it all together. The word pass is no phone, nothing alcohol or addictive, always wear your seatbelt and no speeding, and everybody would make it home alive. These are crashes. These are not accidents. This is everybody is doing things wrong. It's their behavior. 94% of crashes is driver error, driver behavior.
And I think
people making those mistakes.
I think the biggest impact you can make is by joining us on a program like this, by going out and speaking, especially in a high school setting, but yet reaching parents as well, because when you see the photograph like this and realize that a life was lost, as a matter of fact, you wonder how any life could have survived after seeing this kind of wreckage, that this is a real thing, that this happened, and here's the evidence of it. And, you know, do you want your loved one to be involved in the situation like this?
And we are overlooking one thing. The punishment of the tractor-trailer driver was enforced.
I had a fight for that.
Yes.
It didn't come easy,
yep.
But he wound up spending 17 months. The judge said 3 years, 17 months, and I did meet with the guy who killed my son. I met with him after he got out, and I told him I forgave him. I know he didn't mean it. He made a lot of mistakes, but I told him that I didn't want him to carry that burden. He's a broken man. You do not unscathe this.
Sure.
Nobody kills somebody like this, and you walk away never.
No,
we
that's
are
with
affected.
You forever. Yeah.
Right. We are affected forever. He is affected forever. And you know, I told him that I wouldn't be able to do my work, and in my heart, I wouldn't be able to do it. And it was one of the best things that I ever did for myself in my healing process.
17 months was a lot, though, considering this was an involuntary manslaughter deal. That was still
I was told he was never going to spend one day in prison.
How about
that?
See that?
I was told he was going to get probation.
Yeah.
But like I said, people don't realize, and I want people to think when they're driving behind that wheel, do I want to kill myself or do I want to kill somebody else? And how would you hold that burden in your heart when you're behind that wheel? No matter what you're doing, do I want to kill myself or somebody else? You have loved ones at home. You want to make it home to them. So what phone call, text, tweet, email, reaching for a drink
is worth
one second. One second of taking your eyes off that road, is it worth taking a life? You know, it's a responsibility
to drive
that vehicle.
So what do you tell people then when you're speaking to them, when you're even now? What advice do you give them? They're going to have that cell phone with them. They're going to have the GPS in front. What?
My thing I tell them every day is keep your eyes on the road, keep your hands on the wheel, and keep your mind at task. And just drive your vehicle from point A to point B and simply just do that.
Turn the cell phone off?
Turn completely off. Turn your cell phone off. You know, my husband has ALS and we need a cure for that. And the simple cure for distracted driving is right here. It's that off button. It's that off button. We don't need a cure for distracted driving. It's turning it off. Turning all technology off in your vehicle. And
probably that
drive.
Is the, probably, although the things I mentioned can be distractive, this is probably the single,
the
most,
single most
distractive
single
because
most.
If you're checking a turn on a GPS, you're at least doing that like you know you're going to do that.
Do it.
Okay, let's look and let's turn, bad as that may be. But this can go off at any time.
Turn it off. turn it off. And I say it all the time, you know, whenever they hear that ping, they want to keep going for it and going for it. It's like an addiction. They want to keep reaching. They want to look for it, and no matter what, or they'll pull off and then go for it. I'm telling you, when I got the call that my son was killed, you know, I wanted to hurry up and go down there and meet. And then the phone calls kept coming and everybody. And I said to my husband, you know, no sense of speeding to go down there. There's nothing we can do for him now. We did get down there. It was well up. Like you said, the road was closed until 3 o'clock because they had to do the reconstruction.
Yes, it was. Yep.
I didn't get down there until 3 o'clock. I couldn't even recognize him. I literally had to unzip my son's body bag and look at his clothes because he was considered a criminal case. But then they didn't treat it like a criminal case. But I literally had to look at his clothes from the night before to see what he was wearing.
Ask, because we're running short on time, but we mentioned almost casually that in New York State, there's strict enforcement. If an officer sees you go by and you've got a phone, you're getting pulled over.
Right.
Absolutely.
You're getting a ticket.
Correct.
Do we have enough enforcement here in Pennsylvania?
Not for that. Right now we just have the texting bill, which is a $50 fine. That's it. And we do have the new Daniel's Law, which is now if you have injury or if you kill somebody, you can spend up to 5 years in prison. So now we have to decide if the judge, this is what I want to discuss with the judges, is, okay, if you get a broken leg, what are you going to get? If you wind up paralyzed, how much time are you going to get? If you wind up brain dead, but you're not dead, what are you going to get? But if you kill somebody, you can spend up to 5 years.
Yeah.
So we have to see where the judges are going to now decide what you're going to get for what your injuries are.
So you made inroads, but you got a long way to go.
You have a long way to go.
Yeah,
we have a long way to go. But
April's the month for people to think about this. It's Distracted Driving Month. There will be, you know,
every day is.
Well, you're right. You're right. But at least
is.
We know we're
Correct.
Calling special attention right now.
Correct.
I'm sure you're going to see extra public service announcements and things like all reminders to you. And again, when you're talking about your loved ones' lives, you can't put a price on that. So,
no price.
So Eileen, we thank you so much for joining us again. It's a tough subject, but it's an important subject.
Very much so.
And you're the proof of just how tragic this can be. You're also the proof on what we can do if we set our minds to it and just keep working.
Right. So, never let go of the goals.
Yep, absolutely.
Never let go.
Thank you so much for
thank
joining
you for
us.
Always
nice
having
to see
me.
You, Eileen.
Thank you.
Rusty, thanks for
good to see you, David.
Joining in again as usual.
See you next week.
Mark McGlory, thanks for keeping
Mark.
Us in focus.
Thank
He's
you,
behind
Mark.
The camera, folks. I wish we could show him to you, but time does not allow.
Be
I'm
safe.
David DeCosmo for ECTV Live. Until we see you again next week, here's hoping all your news is good.